Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents Betrayal by Will Jordan, narrated by Sam Devereaux. Prologue. Beslan School Number 1, 3rd of September 2004. Numbed by fear and exhaustion, Natasha glanced up from the old scarred wooden floorboards that had been her sole point of focus for the past several hours. Her captor was standing about 10 yards away, puffing absently on a cigarette, the bulky frame of an assault rifle cradled in his arms as he took another deep draw. His features were crude and blunt, characteristic of the men in this part of the country, all pockmarked skin and stubbly beard. His eyes, grey and soulless, were fixed, dead ahead, seeing nothing. What was going on behind those expressionless eyes? A muted cough nearby drew her attention back to her immediate surroundings. More than 500 men, women, and children of all ages were packed into the school exercise hall, crowded in so close that there was scarcely enough space even to sit down. The heat was stifling. The smell of sweat, fear, and stale urine was pervasive. They had been held for 2 days and nights without rest or relief, forbidden to move, forbidden even to talk. When they had first been herded in here, their passage marked by shouting and gunshots, many of the children had been near hysteria with panic. Some had pleaded in vain to be allowed to leave, as if this were a sports day that they could somehow be excused from. Others, too young to understand what was going on, had sought the only reassurance they knew and clustered around their teachers like sheep. But 3 days of constant fear, lack of sleep, and threats of violence had worn the jagged edges of their nerves down, until all Natasha could hear was the occasional cough, groan, and strangled sob. These were a group of people defeated in body and spirit, grimly waiting for what was to come. Most of them had their eyes turned downwards, trying not to be noticed, trying not to do anything that would single them out. They had all learned the value of anonymity. On the first day, their captors had executed one man simply for failing to kneel quickly enough, and another for speaking in the local Ossetian language instead of Russian. On the second day, they had rounded up 20 of the fittest, most capable-looking men and taken them upstairs to the second floor. Moments later, a thundering boom had rolled through the corridors, followed by the chatter of automatic gunfire. None of the men had come back. Natasha's empty stomach growled, the muscles in her abdomen cramping painfully. She hadn't eaten a thing since this had all begun, a fact that her body was reminding her of with increasing urgency. A slender girl of 12 years, she had little enough meat on her bones to begin with, but now she was starting to feel weak and lightheaded as malnutrition took hold. She licked her dry lips, trying to silence thoughts of cool, refreshing water. How many times had she pushed her glass of water aside at the dinner table, pestering her father for fruit juice or a sugary soft drink? She would have killed for that glass now. Her thoughts were interrupted as shouts echoed from the corridor outside the gym hall, making her and the rest of the captives jump in fright. But despite the sudden pounding of her heart, Natasha strained to listen, trying to discern the cause of the commotion. Despite the obvious anger, they didn't seem to be arguing amongst themselves. It was more as though they were yelling for the sake of it, venting their frustration and trying to rally their flagging resolve. They were speaking in Chechen. She couldn't understand what was being said, but it didn't matter. Even she could sense the change in them. Some, like the smoking man nearby, were older, calmer, and in control of their emotions. But most were young, filled with fire and bravado. As the uneasy standoff dragged on without any end in sight, they were growing more frustrated and aggressive. Things were not playing out as they had expected. Something was wrong.
"It's going to happen soon," Natasha whispered. "What are you talking about?"
It was Yelena, a friend she'd known for so long she couldn't remember a time without her. She was a plump sort of girl, not fat as such, but rounded and soft in body, the kind who would blossom into a voluptuous beauty in her teenage years before growing big and matronly as her youth faded. The girl, her dark hair hanging limp and damp around her face, didn't look up from the floor, but Natasha could see her eyes were red from crying. Natasha leaned in closer and nodded towards the gunman who had discarded his cigarette and was now pacing back and forth in front of the door, his broad shoulders hunched with tension.
They're getting more worked up all the time. They're going to do something soon.
Like what?
I don't know.
She swallowed, even though her throat was dry and sore.
Maybe kill us all.
They can't. The soldiers outside will stop them.
It was a weak protest, delivered without conviction. Cut off and isolated as they were, neither could tell what was happening outside. Certainly they had heard the rumble of big vehicle engines, the beating of helicopter blades, and the occasional shouted exchange with the gunman at times, but nothing more. The entire Russian army could be outside, but it didn't make the slightest difference to them.
They didn't stop all those men being killed yesterday,
Natasha reasoned.
Why would it be any different today?
Maybe they'll surrender. They can't want to die here.
Even Natasha sensed the flawed logic in her argument.
Or maybe they're like the men who flew planes into those buildings in America. Maybe they don't care about dying.
Yelena sniffed and shrugged, as if it made no difference to her.
So what? What can we do about it?
That was the question. Natasha wasn't a soldier, but like all living things, the overwhelming, primal instinct in her young mind was to survive.
Be ready to move,
she said. Because wasn't that what people said at times like this? She hoped she sounded more confident than she felt.
When it happens, stay by me.
Seeing the growing defiance and desperation in her friend, Yelena's eyes opened wider.
You're going to get us killed,
she hissed. The girl raised her chin, a tiny flame of anger kindling within her.
Better than letting these bastards kill us,
she said through gritted teeth. She turned her eyes on her friend again.
Yelena, look at me. Look at me.
With great reluctance, her friend's eyes crept up from the floor to meet her own.
I can get us out of here, but only if you trust me. Do you trust me?
Yelena's eyes shone with tears, but she nodded all the same.
Yes.
Natasha reached out and clasped her hand.
We'll get out of this, I promise.
No sooner had they spoken than a fresh round of shouting began in the corridor outside. But this was different from before. The men weren't just yelling to fire themselves up. They were arguing amongst themselves, their aggression growing in intensity. And then, all of a sudden, there were two more gunmen in the gym, both of them young, gaunt, and wild-eyed like horses caught in a stampede. They were brandishing their assault rifles like they intended to use them, and sensing this, the hostages tried in vain to shrink away. It was useless. They were hemmed in by the sheer mass of bodies. The smoking man was weighing into the argument now as well, standing in their path to stop them getting any closer, trying to make them back down. He was a formidable figure, as tall and wide as a doorway to Natasha's young eyes, but his younger comrades were apparently beyond such intimidation now. They had come here to act, and nothing was going to stop them. It happened fast. The older man reached out to grab the nearest one by the arm, but the young man reacted by shoving him away with enough force to put him off balance. Growling with anger, he waded back into the fray, drawing his rifle to swing it like a club. But the second young gunman was ready for him. Raising his assault rifle, he aimed it dead center in the older man's chest and fired. The resulting cacophony of noise echoed around the gym, like the pealing of thunder, mixing with the frightened screams of the hostages as the weapon discharged. The older man crumpled to the ground like a sack of potatoes, his blood staining the floor. People were scrambling away in terror now, as the two gunmen moved further into the room, yelling and screaming as if they had lost whatever self-control they possessed. One of them raised his assault rifle and fired a burst into the ceiling, sending chunks of plaster and broken wood raining down on them. Natasha gripped her friend's hand tight. This was it. This was the moment. They had to act now. Her heart was pounding in her chest, blood rushing through tired muscles, investing them with new strength. It started as a faint whooshing sound from outside, barely heard against the screams and shouts of 500 men, women, and children. But it soon grew in power and intensity until everyone in the hall could hear it. Natasha turned towards the source of the sound, perplexed, despite her fear, wondering what it could mean. The flash lasted only a fraction of a second, but it was bright enough to burn its way onto her retinas, to leave a blurry afterimage flashing across her vision. An instant later, the flash was replaced by a ball of fire that tore through brick walls, reinforcing struts, beams, wooden floorboards, and fragile human bodies without mercy. Natasha was thrown off her feet by the blast, her head slamming onto the hard floor with bruising force. For a moment, she saw and felt nothing but blackness, sheer and absolute. She was in her own world now, a world without pain or fatigue or fear, a world of nothingness. Then, as if heard from a great distance, she became aware of sounds around her, panicked voices, screams of pain and fear, the rhythmic thud of automatic gunfire, the pounding of her own heart, and a distant roar that she couldn't identify. With great effort, she forced her eyes open. The world around her was a nightmare. Something had demolished the far wall of the gym, blasting through the bricks and mortar and turning them into a deadly hail of shrapnel that had torn apart anyone unlucky enough to be caught in their path. There was blood everywhere, and the screams of the wounded and dying mingled horribly with the cries of those now seeking a means of escape. The explosion had also set the roof ablaze, and fire was already clawing at the wooden rafters, filling the air with thick, dark smoke. She could feel the heat even from the other side of the room. More gunfire erupted around them, both inside and outside the school. A full-scale battle had apparently flared up between the gunmen and the Russian police and army outside. The building shook to its foundations as another massive explosion rocked it. Natasha stared again at the hole in the wall. It was a ragged, smoking gap about 8 feet wide, partially blocked by fallen rubble and dead bodies. But beyond the haze of smoke, she could see daylight. That was it. That was their way out. Hope surged through her. This was their chance. Turning away for a moment, she reached down for Yelena, who was lying on the ground beside her.
Yelena, get up! We are getting out now!
She yelled, coughing as the smoke seared her lungs. The fire was raging above them now, pieces of burning wood and insulation falling everywhere. The young girl didn't move. She lay curled in a fetal position, knees drawn up to her chest, eyes staring straight ahead without seeing anything.
Yelena! Wake up!
In desperation, Natasha drew back her hand and slapped her friend across the face with all the strength she could muster. The shock of the blow seemed to snap her out of her reverie, and she looked up at Natasha, eyes wide with fear.
Come on!
Natasha yelled, pulling her friend up.
We have to go!
People were running everywhere in blind panic, some trying to help injured friends, some just searching for a way out. Still clutching Yelena's hand, Natasha pushed her way forwards, getting jostled left and right as people crowded in, all making for the gap in the wall. Her foot caught on something, and she glanced down in time to see the body of one of her friends splayed out on the floor like a rag doll. His torso had been shredded by shrapnel, exposing ribs and charred muscle, and one of his legs had been blasted away. For a moment, she found herself transfixed by the shattered bone and torn flesh where his leg should have been. His lifeless eyes stared upwards, reflecting the flames in the roof overhead. She knew she should have felt horror, should have felt revulsion and grief at the sight, but there was no time to feel for such emotions. Her mind was in survival mode, dealing only with the things it needed to deal with to keep her alive. Instead, she stepped over the body, pushing the horrific image from her mind, concentrating only on getting out. The shooting was growing more intense now. She could hear the whoosh of what sounded like rocket launchers, accompanied by heavy thuds as missiles impacted on the school building. Everywhere there was smoke and fire and confusion and yelling, people clambering over the bodies of the dead and wounded in their terror. She was almost there now. She could see daylight outside.
Yelena, keep moving!
She screamed, yanking her friend's hand with a fierce strength that defied her malnourished body.
We have to!
She never got a chance to finish. A mother of one of the children running in blind panic tripped and fell into her from the side. The impact of the larger and heavier adult knocked her off balance, so that she landed hard on the ground. She tried to keep hold of Yelena's hand, but they were being pulled in opposite directions, and before she knew what was happening, her friend was gone.
Yelena!
She cried, trying to get up. But every time she did, someone would run into her or trip over her, knocking her down once more.
Yelena! Wait!
She gasped in pain as a boot slammed into her chest, bruising her breasts and forcing the air from her lungs. She coughed, trying in vain to breathe the hot, smoke-filled air. She felt as if her ribcage had been caved in. Then, above the roar of the fire, the chatter of the machine gun fire, the pounding of her heart, and the screams of terrified people, she heard her friend's high, thin voice.
Tasha! I can't! I can't!
She caught a momentary glimpse of the young woman's frightened face as she was carried away by the press of people. And just like that, her friend was gone. She tried to follow, but instead found herself jerked backwards as strong hands clamped around her neck, dragging her away from the hole in the wall. One of the gunmen had seized her, she realized. In desperation, she kicked and struggled against his hold, summoning up the last reserves of her failing strength in a vain effort to break free. It was no use. He was twice her size, and many times her match in strength. With one arm locked around her neck, he used his free hand to cuff her across the side of her head. White light and pain exploded through her mind as she went limp in his arms. With a hard yank, she was pulled right off her feet and hauled back through the burning gym. Vaguely, through clouded vision, she realized she was now in the corridor running between the gym and the school cafeteria. The corridor was streaked with bloody footprints, and on her left she saw a body lying curled against the wall, clothes and flesh shredded by bullet holes. Rounding a corner, her captor dragged her into the food hall. The place was in chaos, windows smashed out, chairs scattered everywhere, and tables upended to serve as temporary barricades for the dozen or so gunmen who had decided to make a stand there.
"They've betrayed us!"
one of them shouted in Russian as he fumbled to insert a magazine into his weapon with trembling hands.
"They're going to kill us all!"
His companions were firing indiscriminately at the row of apartment buildings beyond the school gates, the roar of their weapons deafening in the confined space. The floor was covered with broken glass, empty bullet casings, discarded magazines, and blood.
"Move!"
her captor yelled in her ear as he pushed her towards the window.
"Move!"
She tried to comply, but her legs wouldn't work. She was still groggy from the blow to her head, but a hard kick to her back was enough to move her. She fell forwards, gashing her knees on the broken glass. She barely felt the pain now. Staring out into the open space beyond the windows, she froze in horror at the scene unfolding before her eyes. The schoolyard was littered with the bodies of children, teachers, and parents unlucky enough to have been caught in the crossfire between the two sides. Amongst them, curled into a ball as if to hide, she saw the body of a plump girl with dark hair. Yelena. Whatever grief she should have felt at the sight, there was no time for it to sink in. A deep rumble off to her left caught her attention, and she stared open-mouthed as the massive bulk of a battle tank rumbled through the brick wall that marked the boundary of the schoolyard, crashing through the solid barrier as if it wasn't even there. Its domed turret swung around in a measured, unhurried fashion, the long barrel of its main gun eagerly searching for a target. Then it stopped. A brief moment of inaction passed, and with a roar that shook the very ground, it fired. The shell hit one of the classrooms on the first floor of the main building, sending glass and burning debris raining down on the playground. She was not alone by the windows, she realized now. Several men and women of various ages had been lined up next to her and all stood unmoving, some crying in fear, others strangely silent, as if resigned to what was happening. Gunmen were crouched behind them, using them as human shields. Before Natasha could recover enough to get up, she was once more grabbed by the arm and forced to her feet. She could feel the bulk of his body armor pressed against her back, and the rough bristle of his beard brushing her cheek. Thunder erupted beside her as he opened fire, spraying bullets into the schoolyard almost without bothering to aim. To her left, one of the hostages cried out in pain and fell to the ground, blood flowing from his chest and legs. He was followed a moment later by the woman beside him, who took a round to the head that shattered her skull like an eggshell. She crumpled, without as much as a sound. With dawning horror, Natasha realized that it wasn't the gunman who had killed them. It was the Russian soldiers fighting their way into the school. She bucked and lashed out with her feet screaming, arching her back in a last desperate attempt to get away. This wasn't real, her mind screamed at her. This couldn't be happening. Her life had been one of safety and security, each day like the one before. Things like this couldn't happen to her. This wasn't... All such thoughts were silenced when a 7.62mm projectile penetrated her chest, shattering ribs, tearing through internal organs, and blasting out through her back before doing the same to her captor. Her legs gave way beneath her, and she fell to the floor, eyes staring blankly up at the ceiling as the last few seconds of her short life played out. She felt no pain now. She felt nothing except a vague sense of sadness and regret that she would never see her family again, never hear her mother's laugh, or listen to her father chastise her for not drinking her water at dinner. Her last thought was a simple one. Why us? Then her vision faded, and she saw and thought no more. Part 1. Intrusion. In what became known as the Beslan Massacre, 334 people were killed and 728 injured. The majority of those casualties were women and children. Chapter 1. CIA Headquarters, Langley, 19th of December, 2008. Ryan Drake watched as the man before him shifted his weight from one foot to the other, trying and failing to find a comfortable firing stance. The M4 assault rifle at his shoulder was held at an awkward angle that he was sure would cause problems when the shooting started, but he made no move to intervene. He was here as an observer, nothing more. His role was to evaluate the candidate's performance and ultimately decide whether or not he was suitable to join the Shepherd program. It was a task he didn't relish. Drake wasn't accustomed to sitting back and watching good men fail. "Candidate ready?" he asked, when it seemed the shooter had settled down. He couldn't blame the man for being nervous. They both knew what rested on this. There were no second chances when it came to the Shepherd teams. Either you made the grade first time, or you went home.
"Been a while since I heard that."
Cole Mason glanced at him and managed a strained smile before turning his attention back to the rifle range stretching out in front of him. The tension in his body was obvious, even to Drake.
"I'm ready."
"Go hot," Drake instructed, watching as he thumbed off the safety on his weapon. It was loaded with live ammunition for this exercise, and even amongst experienced professionals, there was no room for complacency. Giving Mason a few seconds to prepare, Drake checked his ear protectors were firmly in place, then pressed the little remote trigger in his hand to start the live fire exercise. Straight away, the light levels on the rifle range decreased, and the strained silence of moments earlier was replaced with the loud boom of explosions, the clatter of heavy machine gun fire, and the screams of panicked civilians, all of it blasting through speakers strategically placed around the room. The explosions were accompanied by strobe light flashes and vicious orange glows, designed to simulate the confusion and disorientation of a real combat situation. To his credit, Mason stood his ground, unfazed by the disturbing visual and aural stimulus. He'd experienced this stuff for real plenty of times, and certainly wasn't going to panic at a simulation. Anyway, he knew what he was looking for. And a few moments later, it came. The cardboard representation of a gun-toting militant sprang up from behind a wall, accompanied by another burst of simulated gunfire. Mason reacted immediately. Swinging the barrel of his assault rifle left, he paused a heartbeat to take aim, leaned into it, and fired a burst. His shots impacted a couple of inches off center, but still within the kill zone. The target toppled backwards, effectively dead.
"Come on, Cole," Drake whispered, willing the man to succeed.
His next grouping was better, landing more or less dead center in a target that popped up just 10 yards away. Maybe he'd been wrong, Drake thought. Maybe Mason's years of experience and training would overcome his physical limitations. His hopes were soon dashed when the next target popped up in the window of a building at the far end of the range, meant to represent a sniper taking pot shots at them. Mason's first burst missed entirely, and though his second found its mark, the rounds were scattered all across the cardboard figure. Drake saw Mason flinch at the weapon's recoil, rolling his shoulder as if to loosen it up. Already the air reeked of burned cordite. Hastily ejecting the spent magazine, he reached for a new one on the table in front of him and slapped it into place just as three more figures popped up. Two of them were innocent civilians meant to represent hostages, while the third was their captor. Knowing he had only moments to react, Mason brought his rifle to bear and, driven by the pressure of the moment, opened fire. His hastily aimed burst slammed into the cardboard hostage next to his intended target, undoubtedly dealing a fatal injury had it been a real person. Drake looked down, unwilling to watch as the exercise continued. Already he knew the result, but delivering it was one task that the machines here couldn't help him with. That unpleasant duty fell to him alone. It was a cold, damp Friday evening in the capital, with icy flurries of sleet carried on the fitful breeze as commuters fought their way through rush hour traffic. This close to Christmas, many were heading home via the nearest shopping mall, hoping to grab a few last-minute bargains before the weekend. A woman paused at a busy intersection, waiting for a gap in the traffic so she could cross. She was dressed in a heavy winter overcoat, the collar drawn up to offer some protection from the chill wind. Her short blonde hair was hidden beneath a black stocking cap. A leather gym bag was slung across one shoulder. Just another DC office worker squeezing in a workout before the excesses of the festive season. An older woman, plump and tired, offered her a sympathetic smile as she passed by. She didn't acknowledge it. Spotting a let-up in the traffic, she moved with fast, measured steps across the road, heading down a quieter residential street, towards an apartment building overlooking the nearby freeway. A rumble of traffic and the occasional blast of car horns filtered through the air towards her as she turned left and strode towards the main entrance, unlocking the security door. The public stairwell beyond was clean and well-maintained, just as it had been the last time she came here 2 days ago. There had been a bike chained to the stair banister then, but it was gone now. The place wasn't heated, but warmth from the various apartments had bled out into it, raising the temperature a few degrees higher than outside. Wasting no time, she made for the stairs and started up them. The contents of the sports bag were both heavy and bulky, and by the time she'd reached the third floor, she could feel beads of sweat on her forehead. The stocking cap clung uncomfortably to her head, but she ignored it.
"Hey, you okay?"
a male voice asked from the third floor landing.
"Need a hand?"
She looked over at the tall, slightly overweight man with glasses and a goatee, who had just emerged from his apartment. He was dressed for the winter weather and had likely been on his way out when he'd spotted her.
"Nah, I'm good, thanks," she replied, flashing a grateful smile. "It's a better workout than I get in the damn gym."
He smiled in response, warming to her immediately.
"I hear you. Should do a little more myself," he added.
She noticed he had drawn his stomach in, as men often did when talking to women about exercise. Turning away, she resumed her difficult climb to the top floor. She was grateful when she heard his footsteps receding below, followed by a heavy clang as the front door opened and shut. He might remember her later,
but it wouldn't matter. She'd be gone by then. The building's roof was accessed via a short flight of steps with a fire door at the top, which naturally was alarmed. She had already disabled it during her visit 2 days before, bypassing the door sensor to fool the system into thinking it was locked. Glancing back down the steps for a moment to check she wasn't being watched, she pushed firmly down on the bar to open the door and stepped out. Straight away, she was greeted by a gust of cold wind that tugged at her coat and made her eyes water. After the relative warmth of the stairwell, the sudden change in temperature was almost a shock to the system. Still, it provided a welcome moment of refreshment. Her body was by now well adapted to cold climates, and compared to some of the places she had visited, winter in DC was of little concern. Letting out a breath that steamed in the chill air, she surveyed the area that would act as her vantage point. It was perfect for her needs. Like most buildings in America, the roof was crowded with heating vents, satellite dishes, and air conditioning outlets. The general clutter would provide excellent cover as she went about her work. Stretching out before her like a river of concrete was the 395 freeway, clogged with slow-moving evening traffic. That was good. The slower her targets were moving, the easier her job would be. Chapter 2. Seated in his small, cramped, and cluttered office on the second floor of Langley's old headquarters building, Drake looked up from his computer at the knock on the door. He had a fair idea who was there.
"Come in," he called.
Soon enough, the door opened to reveal Cole Mason. A tall, good-looking man in his late 30s, Mason possessed the dark eyes, olive skin, and jet-black hair characteristic of his Italian ancestry. Only his name seemed to let him down on that front, the result of his grandmother moving to America to escape Mussolini's Italy in the 1930s. Smart move on her part. He had showered and changed out of the t-shirt and combat trousers he'd worn during the live fire exercise, donning a gray business suit that did little to hide his broad-shouldered and muscular physique. He had been hitting the gym hard over the past few months, determined to regain his former strength and fitness. But despite this outward display of robust physical health, the look in his eyes betrayed his lack of confidence as he stepped over the threshold. Nonetheless, he managed a wry smile as he glanced around Drake's disorganized workspace.
"Something's never changed, I see."
Drake avoided his gaze. Some things, unfortunately, did change. Mason wasn't some young, eager recruit fresh off the agency's basic training program, but a seasoned veteran who had served alongside Drake on a dozen occasions in their small but elite group, known as the Shepherd Teams. Their job was to travel to some of the most hostile and dangerous places on Earth and recover lost, missing, captured, or, in rare cases, rogue agency operatives. As such, only the best of the best made the cut. Experienced, quick-thinking, and cool under pressure, Mason had been a natural choice as second-in-command during their ill-fated mission into Russia the previous year. Drake had been handed the daunting task of breaking into a Siberian prison and rescuing an operative known only by her codename, Maras. Against the odds, they had achieved their objective, but a stray round had shattered Mason's shoulder during their escape, putting him out of action and very nearly ending his life. It was a shitty thing to happen to a good man, and more than once Drake had agonized over his responsibility for it. Now, after 18 months, several surgeries, and a grueling period of rehabilitation, Mason had applied to rejoin the Shepherd Teams as an active field agent. Whether or not he was capable of fulfilling this role had been left to Drake to decide. Talk about a poisoned chalice. "Have a seat, mate," Drake said, gesturing to the chair opposite. Mason eased himself down and crossed his legs, fidgeting uncomfortably in the awkward silence that followed. Drake hated this shit, hated having to give bad news to good people, hated deciding men's futures from behind a desk. It wasn't him. It wasn't who he was. Still, he was here, and he had a job to do.
"First of all, I want you to know that you've done an incredible job to get back here," he began. "The work you've put in over the past year..." "Ryan, we've known each other a long time," Mason interrupted. "You don't need to bullshit me.
Let's just get down to it, okay?
He was smiling as if this was just good-natured banter between friends, perhaps hoping to ease the tension. But Drake could sense the nervous anticipation beneath that disarming smile. He supposed he would have felt the same way in Mason's shoes. If Mason wanted the truth, Drake would give it to him.
All right, here's the deal.
He leaned forward, his elbows on the desk as he eyed his friend.
There's no easy way of saying this, so I'll just say it. I'm afraid you haven't made the grade. I'm sorry, mate, but I can't certify you fit to return to duty.
For a long moment, Mason said nothing. He didn't react at all. He just looked at Drake across the desk, as if waiting for him to say something more, to add in something that would turn it all around. It didn't happen. Drake had nothing to give him. The Shepherd teams had no time for guys who made the cut on their third attempt, when they knew what to expect and how to deal with it. Just as there were no second chances out in the field, so it was with training and selection. They were ruthless, because they had to be.
You know the standards they set for Shepherd operatives, Drake went on, more to fill the silence than because he thought his words would offer much comfort. The bar is pretty fucking high, and I can't lower it for anyone, no matter how much I might want to.
So that's it, huh?
Mason finally said, an undertone of bitterness and simmering frustration creeping into his voice.
I'm done. You pack me off and send me home?
Of course not. There are other jobs in the agency.
Doing what? Flipping burgers in the fucking canteen?
Mason snapped, rising to his feet as his temper got the better of him.
That what you think I'm fit for now?
That's not what I meant, Drake said, knowing he had to handle this delicately. You've got years of experience in the field. You could get into training, mission planning, whatever you wanted. There are plenty of opportunities.
No, Ryan,
the older man said, shaking his head vehemently.
I'm no more cut out for that shit than you are. We're both field ops. Always have been. Always will be.
Except one of us doesn't have the tools for the job anymore, Drake couldn't help thinking.
It was a harsh thought to entertain about a man he considered a friend, but theirs was a harsh profession that didn't make allowances for weakness or injury. Calming himself a little, Mason continued.
Look, we both worked together for years, right? You know me. You know what I can do. So I didn't ace every test they threw at me today. So what? I can still do my job out there, where it matters.
He paused a moment, as if sensing the line he was about to cross, then went for it anyway.
It wouldn't be hard to change my scores a little. We both know it's been done before, so why not now? You know I'd have your back if the situation was reversed.
This was a very different man from the one he parted company with after the prison raid, Drake realized now. The Cole Mason he'd known then would never have contemplated what he'd just suggested. Then again, that had been before the painful surgeries, the punishing months of rehab, the financial trouble that came with existing on half pay while his future hung in the balance. Drake understood why he was doing this, why he felt the need to regain everything he'd lost, to prove to himself that he wasn't a useless cripple who couldn't even fire a gun properly. He might well have felt the same way in that position, but this was one line of thought that needed to be stopped right now.
Cole, listen to me now, he said, rising from his chair. I'm going to tell you something you don't want to hear, but for both our sakes, you need to hear it. I know you'd never let me down if you could help it. You were one of the best operatives I ever worked with. But the fact is, you're a liability now. That's a shitty deal, but it's the truth. If I clear you for field ops, I'll be risking the lives of any team you ever serve with. You saw what happened on the rifle range earlier. That could have been me, or Kira, or some innocent civilian caught in the crossfire. You want to live with that for the rest of your life?
He sighed and looked down at his desk for a moment.
You said you'd have my back if the situation was reversed. Well, if it was, I'd expect you to give me the same lecture I just gave you. I'd be pissed off with you, and I'd probably resent you for a long time. But eventually I'd realize you were right. I'm asking you to let this one go, mate. Don't make it any worse for yourself.
That was enough to blunt the edge of Mason's anger. Drake saw him hesitate, realizing that his shortcomings today weren't just bad luck or pedantic adherence to some arbitrary standards, but a simple and unavoidable fact. Despite all the operations and the rehab and the training, he simply wasn't the man he'd once been. I'm sorry, but this was my decision.
Must have been a tough call, huh, Ryan?
He said bitterly. Drake said nothing. Sensing he would get nothing more from his friend, Mason raised his chin a little in a flash of defiance.
Well then, I guess we got nothing more to say,
he decided, his tone now cold and businesslike.
Thanks for the opportunity. Maybe I'll see you around sometime.
He shook hands with Drake, his grip crushingly strong as if to demonstrate the strength he still possessed.
Funny old world, huh?
He said at length, releasing his hand and leaving the office. Letting out a breath, Drake eased himself back into his chair. He'd just destroyed a man's career from the comfort of an office desk. The computer on which he was writing up his final assessment of Mason's performance was his weapon now, and it was just as cruel as any rifle. This wasn't him. This wasn't who he wanted to be. He rubbed his eyes and pushed himself away from the desk, swinging his chair around to stare through his small office window at the dimly lit world beyond. Past the trees that surrounded CIA headquarters lay the distant lights of DC, shrouded in somber gray clouds. It was early evening in December, and getting dark fast, with flurries of sleet pattering against the window. Again, he replayed the events of that night last year. The dangerous raid on the remote Russian prison, the decisions he'd made, the things he could have done differently. He'd been through it more times than he could count, but Mason's appearance today had triggered the memories once again. In retrospect, nothing good had come out of that mission. The rescue of that enigmatic prisoner had started a chain of events that had very nearly ended Drake's life, not to mention that of his sister and her family back in the UK, ruined his career, and left him trapped in an uneasy standoff with powerful men who wanted him dead. And yet again today, he'd been confronted with another reminder of the consequences of his actions. Fuck this, he growled, rising from his chair. The report could wait until tomorrow. It was nothing more than an autopsy anyway. Whatever he noted in it, it wouldn't change the fact that the patient was dead. Explaining how and why it had happened was a task he didn't feel up to completing tonight. Grabbing his coat off the back of the door, he jammed his hands in the pockets, feeling for his car keys. Laying aside the heavy sports bag, Anya knelt down and unzipped it, exposing the carefully wrapped package within, a KSVK sniper rifle, stripped and dismantled for easy transport. With the efficient, unhurried ease born from long practice, she set to work reassembling the weapon, clipping together the breech mechanism before attaching the enormous meter-long barrel. A quick test pull of the trigger confirmed that the firing mechanism was in good order, after which she attached the scope to the rail mounted on top of the weapon. The last task was to insert the magazine. She didn't slam it into place the way they did in the movies, but simply applied firm pressure to push it home until she felt the click as the locking pins engaged. A slight downward pull was enough to assure her the magazine was secure. Reaching into her pocket, she fished out a Bluetooth earpiece and fitted it to her left ear, then powered up her cell phone and dialed a number from memory. It was answered immediately. There was no greeting. The ringing simply stopped.
I'm Green, she reported. When do we start?
Our friends are on their way. 15 minutes.
Understood.
There was no need for further conversation. Both she and her contact knew what had to be done. It was simply a case of doing the most difficult part of any sniper's job. Waiting. Drake emerged from the liquor store clutching a carefully wrapped bottle of wine, his head down and his coat turned up against the driving sleet and hail that pelted him with each gust of wind. It was a miserable evening, and not likely to get much better by his estimation. He'd gone for a 5-year-old bottle of Sauvignon Blanc, thinking it was fairly forgiving stuff that most people could drink easily. but now he was starting to wonder if he should have bought a Chablis Chardonnay instead. Jesus Christ, Ryan, it's a bottle of wine, he said under his breath, giving himself a mental slapping. In this case, however, it was more than a bottle of wine. It was a peace offering. It wasn't much in the way of recompense considering how he'd treated the intended recipient over the past couple of months, but it was the best he could come up with. He was just approaching his car when he felt his phone go off in his pocket, signaling an incoming text message. For a moment, Drake was tempted to leave it. He suspected it was work-related and was in no mood for dealing with some boring administrative issue at 6 p.m. on a Friday. Still, he wasn't the sort to leave a message unread. Curiosity and a frustratingly innate sense of duty compelled him to take a look. Laying the bottle down on the passenger seat, he powered the phone up and opened the text. His curiosity soon intensified when the sender came up as anonymous. But more intriguingly still was the message itself. Ryan, we need to talk. 1st Street and Delaware Avenue. 10 minutes. Drake felt a chill of anticipation run through him as he scanned the message again. It was impossible to tell from such an impersonal form of communication, but the style matched that of a woman who was accustomed to arranging such clandestine meetings at short notice. A woman he hadn't seen since his return from a mission in Afghanistan 4 months ago that had seen one of his team dead. A woman he couldn't afford to ignore now. If she had taken the risk of making contact in the heart of DC, she must have something important to tell him. Either way, he knew he had to get to her. Pocketing the phone, he jumped in the driver's seat, glancing for a moment at the bottle of wine lying on the other side. He had a fleeting moment of regret, knowing what it represented. Peace offerings would have to wait for now, he thought, as he fired up the engine and pulled out into the busy road, gunning the accelerator hard to avoid hitting an oncoming bus. Chapter 3. Central DC was in a state of organized chaos as Drake tried to fight his way through the rush hour traffic, maneuvering his car through spaces it had no business trying to fit through, taking side streets and any possible shortcuts he could think of. Despite his best efforts, he was forced to abandon his car in a residential area several blocks south of the meeting place and make his way there on foot, doing his best to ignore the stinging hail and sleet that had been getting dumped on the Capitol all day. It was a miserable evening, but in truth, his mind wasn't on the weather. If he was right, then the person waiting for him a few blocks away was someone he'd spent much of the past 18 months searching for. Anya, the woman he'd been charged with liberating from a Russian prison last year. Once known by her codename Maris, she'd been one of the agency's best field operatives in her time. She had also been an infrequent but profound influence on his life ever since that night, her presence often heralding great upheaval and danger. But as much as it galled him to admit it, she was also his lifeline, the one person on this earth who could unravel the web of deceit and betrayal that reached to the top echelons of the agency. Only time would tell whether she held the key to setting things right. However, there was always a chance that his enigmatic contact wasn't Anya at all. If so, he intended to be ready. Reaching into his pocket, he felt the solid frame of the 9mm Sig Sauer automatic, taken from the glove compartment of his car just before he dumped it. He always kept a weapon there these days. The corner of 1st Street and Delaware was, on the whole, a pretty unremarkable area for such a meeting. Looking around, he saw little of interest on the unassuming tree-lined roads, except an apartment complex to the northeast, with rows of two-story residential houses opposite. The cars parked beside them confirmed his suspicion that this was a less than affluent neighborhood. A Baptist church stood on the southeast corner. Judging by the sounds drifting out on the cold air, it was the kind of place where they did a lot of gospel singing and tambourine banging. At least someone was having a good evening. Traffic chugged past on both main roads, less congested here than on the big freeway a short distance to the north, but enough to make crossing a dicey affair. There were almost no pedestrians, save for an overweight old man out walking his dog on the grassy area near the low-rise apartments. Drake couldn't hide a flicker of amusement as the man pretended not to notice his charge hunker down and leave a big steaming turd on the grass, walking on as if nothing had happened. He'd used the same tactic himself when forced to take the family dog for morning walks as a kid. The only thing missing in this picture of urban blandness was Anya. That wasn't surprising in itself. She always controlled the time and place of their meetings, and saw to it that he didn't find her until she wanted to be found. But it wasn't in her nature to be tardy. Pulling his jacket collar up, Drake looked down at his watch. It had been well over 10 minutes since her text message. Where was she? The light levels were falling rapidly up on the roof. It was winter, the sun had set about half an hour earlier, and darkness was descending on the capital. For Anya, it was perfect. The brightly lit highway in front of her made picking targets easy, while the gathering dark kept her position safely obscured. Not that she had to worry. There were few buildings in the vicinity that overlooked this rooftop. That was one of the reasons she'd chosen it in the first place.
1 minute.
Gritting her teeth, she heaved the bulky weapon up onto the metal air vent cover beside her, allowing it to rest on its integral bipod as she worked the bolt action, drawing the first round into the breech. The KSVK held 5 rounds of 12.7 by 108mm armor-piercing ammunition, powerful enough to punch through the metal skin of the average APC and kill anything on the other side. 2 targets, 5 rounds, no time to change magazines.
30 seconds.
Anya reckoned the wind speed at about 6 or 7 knots, blowing more or less straight towards her from the east. It wouldn't divert the rounds off target, but it would contribute to a slight drop in shot as each projectile had more air to travel through. She adjusted the scope's lateral compensation a couple of notches and settled in behind it, finding a comfortable position for the butt against her shoulder.
20 seconds.
Closing her eyes, she allowed her breathing to come slower and deeper, her heart rate to calm, her muscles to relax. Sniping was one of the most difficult skills for any operative to master, years of training and preparation all coming down to a single moment of truth. One shot, one chance, one kill.
10 seconds.
Opening her eyes once more, she leaned into the scope, surveying the traffic on the freeway until she found what she was looking for. A pair of silver Mercedes-Benz sedans traveling in loose convoy in the center lane. Distance, 700 meters. Speed, approximately 40 miles per hour.
5 seconds.
She needed no prompting now. Sighting the second car in the convoy, she focused in on the left side of the windshield. The glass was tinted, as it often was on official vehicles, making it difficult to see the driver. But it didn't matter. She was familiar with the make and model of the car, and knew exactly where he would be seated. A gloved finger tightened on the trigger.
Now.
Exhaling slowly, she fired. The recoil of a single 12.0mm round slammed the weapon back into her shoulder with bruising force. The blast from the muzzle caused a shockwave to spread across the metal vent cover in front of her, raising tiny showers of water, while the boom of the discharging round left her ears ringing. Half a second later, she watched as the toughened windshield exploded inwards, accompanied by a sudden cloud of red that coated the broken glass. Straight away, her right hand was moving, working the bolt to eject the spent cartridge and draw a fresh one into the breech. There was a loud click as the moving parts worked, followed by a dull ping as the spent casing clattered onto the rooftop, smoking and sizzling where it rested on the damp surface. She was no longer looking at the second car in the convoy. That was done now. It would only be a matter of moments before the driver of the lead vehicle looked behind and realized something was wrong. There was a brief blur of movement as she shifted her aim, focusing on the lead vehicle. Her shoulder was aching now from the impact, but she ignored the pain as she worked the bolt action, lining up her second shot. Vaguely, she was aware of the growing panic on the highway as her first target slewed sideways, crashing into a people carrier and pinning the lighter vehicle against the freeway's concrete wall. Horn blasts and the screech of brakes filled the air as motorists tried to work out what was happening. The driver of the lead Mercedes had picked up on it too, but unlike the bored commuters around him, he knew exactly what to do and jammed his foot down on the accelerator. His training would have kicked in now, telling him to speed up, put in evasive maneuvers, get clear of the kill zone as fast as possible. Anya could tell he was heading for an off-ramp about 100 yards further down the freeway, part of a big interchange between two other main drags. Unfortunately, to get there, he had no choice but to come straight at her. With the second round now chambered, she swung the long, eager barrel left, tracking her target as it tried to weave through the dense traffic. The driver's efforts were in vain, as she sent a round straight for him, punching through the windshield and killing him instantly. Caught in the midst of a sharp left turn, the Mercedes yawed hard and slammed into the central reservation before flipping and rolling over. Two shots, two kills. She had done her part. The rest was out of her hands. Drake started at the muted boom of the first shot, wondering for a moment if he had heard the crack of thunder in the darkened skies overhead. However, the second shot a few seconds later, followed by a crash and the blare of car horns on the nearby freeway, quickly shattered that illusion. Someone was firing on the slow-moving traffic. He knew the sound of a high-powered sniper rifle well enough, and his experiences of urban combat told him it had come from nearby. Straight away, his mind switched gears, his training as a field operative taking over without conscious thought, quickly assessing what he knew so far and combining it with experience and intuition to decide on a course of action. It was no coincidence that such an attack should have happened at the same time and location he'd agreed to meet with Anya. For all he knew, the sniper might have been sent specifically to take her out, in which case she could be injured or even dead already. He had no idea how they had learned of the meeting, and now wasn't the time to ponder such questions. What mattered was what he did in the next few seconds. He himself was standing at an open crossroads, totally exposed and easy prey for a skilled sniper. He certainly couldn't stay here, and fleeing would be an exercise in futility. Modern sniper rifles were accurate at up to 1,000 yards or more, and he had no desire to put that to the test. No, his best chance was to get to them and take them out. The only question was where they had located themselves. Urban environments with lots of high walls and sharp angles can do strange things to the acoustics of gunshots, deflecting the sound waves and making it difficult to pinpoint the origin of individual shots. In part, this is why snipers flourish in city fighting. The only way to find the shooter in this case was to consider his or her possible firing positions, pick one, and hope it was right. In the space of a second or two, Drake quickly took in his surroundings, noting nearby buildings that would make good vantage points. The 395 was an elevated freeway, meaning most of the low-rise residential buildings and shops in the vicinity were beneath road level. To the north, an office building that he vaguely recognized as belonging to Michigan State University rose up into the night sky. Certainly it was tall enough to provide a good field of fire over the freeway, but buildings like that had cameras, armed security guards, alarms, all of which would have to be meticulously bypassed and neutralized. Not a good place for a sniper to set up. There was the church across the way. Its bell tower was certainly tall enough to overlook the freeway, but there was no way anyone could get a sniper rifle past a full congregation and make entry to it, no matter how hard they were banging their tambourines. Then, at last, he saw what he was looking for. The residential apartment block, easily 5 stories high and overlooking the big interchange between the 395 and two other main drags heading north and south. Its flat roof offered a perfect field of fire for a skilled sniper, and security was likely to be light there. He was moving before he even had a chance to finish that thought, reaching for his cell phone and quickly dialing 911 as he sprinted across the road, ignoring the angry horn blasts that followed him.
911 emergency,
came the crisp voice of a female operator a few moments later.
Shots fired on the corner of First Street and Delaware, the apartment building at the crossroads, Drake said, making a beeline for the nearest door. Sniper, probably targeting the freeway. Send everything you got in the area right now.
With that, he closed down the call. He had no time to give a detailed description of what he'd seen and heard. He had more important matters to attend to. Drawing the SIG, he shoved his way through the main doors and into the bland, clinical-looking communal stairwell beyond. To his left stood an elevator, with an out-of-order sign affixed to it. Good. One way in, one way out. Gripping the weapon tight, he sprinted up the stairs, taking them two at a time as he made for the roof. His breath was soon coming in deep gasps, his heart pounding, but his pace showed no signs of slowing. Adrenaline was doing a good job of maintaining his energy. On the top floor, he spotted a teenage girl in a black hoodie emerging from one of the apartments, earphones on and head down as she flicked through songs on her iPod. Taking one look at Drake and the weapon he was clutching, she let out a startled cry.
Oh, fuck!
With that, she retreated into her home and slammed the door shut. She wasn't what he was looking for. Drake paid her no heed as he focused on the stairway leading to the roof. Glancing at the weapon to check the safety was disengaged, he advanced up the stairs, keeping his eye on the sliver of light around the edge of the door. Halting at the top, he took a deep breath to get his breathing under control. His wait lasted only a second or two. Never delay longer than you have to, he'd been taught long before. The anticipation only works against you. Go now. A single hard kick to the release bar was enough to send the door flying outwards, allowing cold air and hard pellets of frozen rain to rush in. Ignoring it, Drake advanced onto the roof, his eyes on weapons sweeping the area, eager for a target. The sniper's weapon lay on the gravel-covered roof next to a big box-like air vent. He didn't recognize the model, but it definitely wasn't British or American in origin. However, it was a beast of a gun, easily 6 feet long and probably weighing at least 25 pounds, the kind of heavy-duty sniper rifle designed to punch through light vehicle armor. The weapon was less of a concern to him at that moment than its owner, who had abandoned the gun and was standing on the low parapet at the edge of the roof, as if he or she intended to jump. The face was hidden, but the general build and height suggested that the sniper was a woman. The moment he emerged onto the roof, she started to turn. He saw a sudden movement, the distinctive action of someone reaching for a concealed weapon, and instinctively brought the SIG to bear.
Freeze!
Drake ordered. At this range, he could hardly miss. Drake watched as the lone figure on the edge of the roof turned to face him, revealing attractive, finely chiseled features, a straight nose, a firm jaw, and strong, intense blue eyes that were locked with his. In an instant, everything around him faded away into darkness. The weapon in his hands seemed to lower of its own volition, as he stared in disbelief at the woman he knew all too well.
Anya?
He gasped, the rush of his pursuit giving way to shocked disbelief. She looked at him for a long moment, saying nothing. As always, it was impossible to know what was going on behind those icy blue eyes of hers. Then, without warning, she took a single step back over the edge of the parapet and disappeared. Drake let out a breath. The image that had appeared before him and then vanished so abruptly felt like a dream. It didn't seem real. Only when he saw the rope affixed to one of the rooftop heating outlets did reality snap back into place. He rushed over to the parapet in time to see the woman disengage herself from the abseiling gear 50 feet below. Casting a brief glance up at him, she turned and sprinted off, vanishing into the shadows beneath some trees on the edge of a park area below. Just as suddenly as she had reappeared in his life, Anya was gone. Chapter 4. For the next few seconds, Drake just stood there, trying to make sense of what he'd seen and heard. As inconceivable as it sounded, it appeared Anya was responsible for a sniper attack on a crowded freeway in central DC. And judging by the chaos on the multi-lane highway below, she had caused casualties. But who or what had been her target? Peering through the gloom and rain, he did his best to survey the scene. At least 6 or 7 cars, vans, and trucks had been involved in the smash, probably as collateral damage rather than because they were specifically targeted. The two vehicles that seemed to have borne the brunt of the attack were a pair of luxury Mercedes-Benz S-Class sedans, both silver-colored, and both likely to have been traveling in convoy. Drake had seen enough foreign diplomats arriving for high-level conferences to recognize the kind of vehicles they liked to cruise around in. Powerful, maneuverable, and sturdy enough to bear the weight of concealed armor plating and toughened glass, these two mercs were prime candidates for such duty. But whatever countermeasures they'd been fitted with, it hadn't been enough to protect them from Anya's attack. One had crashed into the central reservation, rolling several times before coming to a halt as a mangled, deformed mess, while a second had swerved to the right and broadsided a Ford people carrier, forcing it into the opposite wall.
Already he could see the distinctive flashing lights of an ambulance approaching the crash site, the backed-up traffic moving aside as best it could to make way for the emergency vehicle. It screeched to a halt beside the second of the two Mercs. The rear door flew open and a pair of paramedics leapt out. The glow of headlights on the freeway made it hard for Drake to discern what was going on, but he frowned in surprise when the doors slammed shut and the ambulance accelerated away after just a few moments, leaving the other crashed vehicles unchecked. Either they had been advised that other medical units were inbound, or they had a patient on board with critical injuries. But if so, how had they managed to get them out of the wreckage so quickly? And for that matter, how had they arrived on the scene mere seconds after the attack? Even if other drivers on the freeway had called in the crash immediately, it would take at least 30 seconds for their calls to be answered and processed, and emergency services vectored in. Everything about this was setting off alarm bells in his head. Holstering the SIG, he reached for his cell phone.
"Sir, put your hands up where I can see them," a voice called out from behind.
Deep, powerful, authoritative, the voice of a cop with his gun trained on a suspected terrorist. Drake closed his eyes for a moment, realizing that his warning to the Metro PD might have worked rather better than he'd expected. Never had he imagined they would arrive so quickly and at such an inconvenient moment. Being caught in the sniper's nest with the weapon itself mere yards away was going to take some explaining.
"I'm not the man you're looking for," Drake said, raising his hands slowly. Cops only use their weapons as a last resort, but he didn't want to give the man any excuse to open fire.
"I called this one in. I'm on your side."
"So we'll take your word for that, huh?"
A different voice this time. High, young, female. Cops usually traveled in pairs.
"We'll get to that later, sir," the first cop decided. "Right now I want you to get down on your knees with your hands behind your head."
Shit. Explaining himself from the back of a police cruiser could waste hours. Meanwhile, Anya and the mysterious ambulance on the freeway below were getting further away by the second. Not to mention the inevitable questions that would arise over why he was here in the first place and the text message on his cell phone. He'd deleted it, of course, but even he knew that a skilled technician could recover it with ease. Drake's heart was beating faster as he considered his options. The sudden arrival of these two cops less than 2 minutes after his 911 call, much like the ambulance on the freeway, bore all the hallmarks of a setup. Had someone called this in before he'd even arrived? If so, who?
"Sir, I'm not going to ask you again," the cop went on, sensing his hesitation. "Get down on your knees. Come on, pal. This isn't worth it."
Resisting arrest wasn't going to do him any favors. There were two of them and only one of him, and he had his back to them. They had the drop on him. Slowly, he lowered himself to his knees, the rough gravel of the rooftop biting into his skin as he did so, and placed his hands behind his head. He put enough targets in this position to know they were about to handcuff him. He heard the squelch of a radio.
"This is Unit 7. Possible suspect apprehended on the roof of previous address," he heard the female cop say. "Requesting backup to secure the scene."
The crunch of boots on gravel as the first cop approached. He would have holstered his weapon and reached for the cuffs at his belt while his partner covered him. Securing the suspect was the most dangerous part of any arrest, because you had to come into contact with them in order to snap the cuffs on. In that short time before you had them subdued, you were vulnerable. And just like that, Drake had settled on a course of action. It happened fast. Just as Drake felt a strong grip clamp around his left wrist to snap the cuffs on, he clenched his right hand, twisted around, and drove it into the cop's groin with all the force he could summon. Normally, he would have aimed for the abdomen to knock the wind out of him, but like any street cop, he was almost certain to be wearing a ballistic vest. They were more effective at stopping bullets than fists, but the last thing he needed was to break his hand on an inconveniently placed piece of armor. In any case, his aim was true, and the cop let out a grunt of pain as Drake's fist connected. Before he could double over, Drake had wrenched his other hand free of the man's grip and jumped to his feet, instinctively reaching for the holster at the cop's right hip. Really, he had no idea if the weapon was on the left or the right side, but since most people were right-handed, he was prepared to take a chance. Sure enough, he felt his fingers close around the butt of an automatic.
Yanking it free from the holster, he brought it up and jammed it against the cop's neck, forcing the man to turn so that he was positioned between Drake and his partner. The entire action had taken just over 3 seconds. Fortunately for Drake, the man he was now using as a human shield was more than up to the task. Standing a couple of inches above 6 feet, his heavy frame suggested a passion for weightlifting, though poor diet or lack of cardio training had left him bulked up and barrel-chested rather than lean and trim. Still, he was a serious-looking man who could easily overpower Drake in terms of brute strength. Only the gun now pressed against his flesh was keeping him under control. His female comrade had been unable to intervene. She was too far away to get involved physically, while a bit of careful positioning on Drake's part had prevented her getting a clear shot. Now she was trying to decide what to do, whether it was worth the risk of opening fire. Drake surveyed her, quickly sizing her up. She was young, probably mid-20s, with a full figure that was tending towards plump, and short black hair tied back tight. Her dark eyes and olive skin suggested Hispanic origin, and the name Cortez printed on the tag on her jacket confirmed it. If he had had to guess, he'd say she was a rookie, probably partnered up with an older and more experienced officer until she learned the ropes. Today, however, she was about to learn a different kind of lesson. "Forget it," Drake said, crouching low to hide himself behind the cop's considerable frame. Neither of them had seen his face, and he wanted to keep it that way. "Lower the gun and step back, and you both get to live." She shook her head vehemently. "Bullshit! I lower it! You kill both of us!" She wasn't about to give up her only leverage. Credit where it was due, she was tougher than she looked. But being tough was a poor substitute for being smart, and he needed her to see that her position was untenable. "I've got no interest in either of you, Cortez," he promised her. "I'm not responsible for this attack, but I can't let you take me in. You can either walk away from this or you can get yourself and your partner killed trying to stop me. It's up to you." Even as he said this, he was edging closer to the stairwell door, keeping his human shield in front. Instinctively, Cortez took a step backwards, keeping her distance. She couldn't get a decent shot at Drake, so aside from shooting through her partner, there was little she could do to stop him.
"You're wasting your time, man,"
the first cop warned him, his deep baritone voice seeming to resonate through his entire body as he spoke.
"We've got backup inbound. You won't make it 2 blocks.
"Then there's no reason not to let me go," Drake countered, still moving towards the door. "Better than getting killed." He saw Cortez's eyes waver for a moment, saw the barrel of her automatic lower just a little. She wasn't giving up her weapon, but the meaning was clear all the same. She was letting him go, just as he knew she would. Movies often depict the heroic cop finding an ingenious way out of such situations, whether it be shooting the hostage taker in the leg to disable him or using some trick to distract him. But the reality was often far more pragmatic. Cortez didn't want to die here, and she didn't want her partner to die either. Neither death was worth the life of some anonymous nutjob, and they all knew it. He was close enough. Releasing his grip on his hostage, Drake planted a firm kick in the small of his back that sent him staggering towards Cortez, blocking her shot for a few precious moments. Without waiting to see the results, he turned and sprinted through the door, slamming it shut behind him. The security bar would only allow it to open from inside, and short of blasting the entire door apart, there was little chance of Cortez and her partner giving chase. Still, Drake wasn't hanging around to find out. Rushing down the stairwell and back outside, he passed the police cruiser parked outside the apartment block and headed west, away from the freeway and the heavy traffic that was already starting to back up around it. Once he was sure he was out of sight of the apartment building, he turned south and picked up the pace. His car was 2 blocks away, and he needed to get to it fast. Keeping his head down, he turned off the main drag and took a footpath running through a grassy area between 2 residential buildings, then fished out his cell phone and hurriedly scrolled through the list of apps until he found one with the innocuous title, Date Calculator. At first glance, it appeared to be nothing more interesting than a personal organizer, but in reality, it was a sophisticated piece of encryption software developed by the agency to allow their operatives to make calls without fear of interception.
In Drake's case, it allowed him to speak freely with other people on the same encryption scheme. Even the agency itself couldn't listen in. Inputting his personal access code, he waited a few seconds while date calculator enabled secure mode, then finally dialed the number he wanted. Technically, it was after hours, but Drake knew the man he was calling didn't keep to office hours any more than he did. It was one of the perks, or otherwise, of being the director of the CIA's Special Activities Division. As he expected, it rang several times before it was answered. The recipient of the call would have to input his own access code to allow date calculator to link the two phones and create a secure line.
"Yo, Ryan,"
Dan Franklin answered at last, sounding more harassed than usual. Drake and the director of special activities had served in the same composite unit in Afghanistan years earlier and had forged a strong friendship during their tour together. Their lives and careers had taken different paths since then, and the burden of leadership had strained their relationship more than once. But Drake still considered Franklin a friend, and he had few enough of those nowadays. In this case, however, he wasted no time on greetings.
"Dan, we've got a problem."
"What kind of problem?"
"The kind when someone caps off shots from a high-powered sniper rifle into a busy freeway."
That was enough to get his friend's attention.
"And you know this how?"
"Take a guess." Drake paused a moment, waiting until he'd passed by a runner out for some evening exercise before carrying on.
"I was opposite the building when the shooting started. It was overlooking the 395 just west of Garfield Park."
"Jesus, a Metro PD aware?"
"You could say that. Two of their guys just tried to arrest me."
His words weren't lost on Franklin.
"What do you mean, tried?"
Drake winced inwardly.
"Had to give him the slip."
"Christ, Ryan. You're supposed to be a case officer, not Jason fucking Bourne. You aiming for a spot on America's Most Wanted?"
"You don't understand. They turned up right after I did,"
Drake hurriedly explained.
"Unless they happened to be passing by when the shooting started, there's no way they could have got there so fast, which means they were tipped off in advance. Someone was trying to set me up, Dan."
"Possible, but who?"
He paused for a moment, wondering whether he was doing the right thing by dumping this on his friend. But he knew he couldn't sit on it and do nothing. Franklin had to know. Anya. At that moment, any lingering doubts Franklin might have had about the severity of this call vanished.
"You're sure?"
"Pretty sure," Drake said, recalling that moment up on the roof. "She was standing right in front of me. Looks like she was the shooter."
"Any idea what the target was?"
"I saw a pair of luxury Mercs on the freeway that looked like they'd been fucked over. Couldn't make out the plates, but I think they were part of a diplomatic convoy. Join the dots and it looks a lot like an assassination."
His friend exhaled, digesting everything he'd just heard.
"Talk about stirring up a hornet's nest. What the hell is she up to?"
"Your guess is as good as mine right now," Drake admitted. "Listen, I need you to do me a favor."
"What's that?"
"The police weren't the only ones to arrive in a hurry. An ambulance pulled up at the crash site within seconds, then left in a big hurry. I couldn't see what they were up to, but it didn't look right to me. Can you check around the local hospitals and see if they brought in any crash victims? The closest one from here is George Washington University."
"I'll see what I can do. What about you?"
"I'm getting the fuck out of here," he replied, fully intending to put as much distance between himself and those two cops as possible.
"Good. Try to stay out of trouble."
"You know me," Drake assured him.
"That's what I'm talking about."
There wasn't much Drake could add to that. Closing down the call, he pocketed the phone and pressed on, keeping his head down to shield himself both from bad weather and from curious onlookers. His car, a black Audi S5, was still sitting where he'd left it. A quick flash of the key fob disabled the alarm. Drake couldn't get inside fast enough, eager to both escape the biting wind and to get away from the crime scene. Within seconds, he was off and moving, and once again, he fired up his cell phone. Chapter 5. With a strained, breathless cry, Kira Frost closed her eyes, arched her back, and dug in her nails. The taut muscles of her body held rigid as the sensations within her built to an unbearable crescendo and then finally exploded with glorious release. Breathing hard and still quivering with aftershocks of pleasure, she opened her eyes and collapsed on top of her partner,
for the moment, absolutely spent.
Fuck yeah,
she said, her voice low and husky. She could feel the fast and powerful beat of his heart as she rested her head on his chest. Rick Barkley, a mechanic at her local bike shop, mid-20s, tall and well-built, with scruffy blonde hair and a jawline permanently roughened by several days' growth, he'd caught her eye the very first time she'd met him. She'd known he felt the same way about her, though it had taken him a couple of months to work up the courage to ask her on a date. Normally, she had no time for men who were indecisive or timid, but in his case, she'd sensed another motive for his hesitation. He'd been trying to play the gentleman by not making his interest too obvious. Fortunately for him, Frost wasn't looking for a gentleman. She'd told him as much about an hour ago.
Worth waiting for,
he said breathlessly, the words rumbling against her ear. Grinning, Frost sat up, leaned over him and picked up a half-empty bottle of Corona from the bedside table, downing it in one gulp. Still flushed with the post-orgasmic glow, she was feeling pretty good about herself at that moment. All things considered, she liked Rick. He was smart without being a smartass, confident without being a domineering jerk, and as she'd just discovered, he wasn't entirely clueless between the sheets either. Might be worth keeping around for a while, she mused, and maybe putting his skills to the test again later. She turned towards him, curious as to whether he was ready for round two, only to find him staring at her. But his look wasn't the glassy-eyed stare of a satisfied partner. Rather, she saw curiosity, surprise, and even a hint of suspicion in them. And she knew why. Sitting upright and naked as she was, it was inevitable that his eyes would stray across her exposed body. The demands of her difficult and dangerous job as a shepherd specialist had endowed her with the firm musculature and toned physique of a professional athlete, but they had also left another legacy that she was less enthusiastic about.
What did you say you did again?
Rick asked, eyeing the jagged knife scar on the left side of her ribcage, a little memento of an operation in Somalia, where she'd discovered that stab vests weren't all they were cracked up to be. Frost felt a brief flash of annoyance and, much to her chagrin, self-consciousness. She'd never had any hang-ups about her body, had never fretted and agonized in front of the mirror, wishing her breasts were bigger or her ass smaller. But in situations like this, the physical toll her work was taking was becoming harder and harder to hide, and it wasn't something she liked. In any case, what was she supposed to say? She certainly couldn't tell him that she was a highly trained CIA operative who took part in clandestine operations in foreign countries. For one thing, it would put Rick's job selling engine parts at the bike shop into serious perspective, and for another, she simply wasn't allowed to talk about it.
I didn't,
she replied, leaning forward and kissing his neck as she allowed her hand to stray down to his crotch.
Isn't it more interesting that way?
His mind might still have been filled with questions, but it was obvious enough what his body wanted. And as her movements became more forceful, the body began to gain control over the mind. She was just beginning to feel her own desire rise when her phone started ringing, abruptly shattering the moment.
You're fucking kidding me, she said under her breath.
Leave it,
Rick grunted, kissing the sensitive skin on her neck and working his way down to her breasts. Frost hesitated, looking over at the phone on her bedside table. There weren't many people who knew her private cell number, and she had worked hard to keep it that way over the years. She had no time for idle chit-chat, and even less for telemarketers. If someone was calling, it was likely a family member. Or...
Hold that thought,
she said, pulling away from him and snatching up the phone. It was Drake.
What is it, Ryan?
She began, unable to keep from sounding a little flustered. And typical of Drake, he picked up on it right away.
Caught you at a bad time.
She could have sworn the son of a bitch was smirking.
I'm allowed a life outside work,
she pointed out irritably, even if you're not.
Fair one.
He was wise enough not to rise to her rebuke.
I'll need your help.
She heard movement on the bed behind her and felt Rick's hands encircle her waist, moving upwards to cup her breasts, gently squeezing and caressing. Normally, she wouldn't object to such a move, but right now she needed to concentrate. "With what?" she asked, trying to shrug out of his embrace. "There's been a sniper attack on a freeway in central DC. Looks like a possible assassination." Rick wasn't getting the message. It was time for a less subtle approach. Reaching behind her, she got a good grip of his genitals and twisted. Not quite hard enough to cause damage, but enough to show she could if he didn't back off. Straight away, he let go. "And you're involved?" she asked, as if nothing had happened.
"I am now," Drake remarked. "An ambulance was on the scene right after the attack. I want to know where it went."
"Maybe a hospital?" she suggested with unveiled sarcasm.
"Thanks for the insight, but I doubt this one was on the books. It happened too fast."
"You think it was a lift?"
"Maybe. Either way, someone went to a lot of trouble to set this up, and I want to know why. I need someone who can backtrack surveillance footage of the attack, and you're the best I can think of."
Frost rolled her eyes.
"Fuck off, Ryan. Flattery doesn't suit you."
"I'm working on that. The attack happened 10 minutes ago, on the 395 just west of Garfield Park. Can you access traffic cam footage and figure out what happened?"
She reached for her beer and downed the dregs. With her agency security clearance, she can access virtually any police or civilian system. And like any technical specialist, her home setup was easily on a par with anything she could put together at Langley.
"Okay, fine. I'll save the day for you. Again. Just remember this shit next time we're discussing my annual bonus."
"No promises," he said. "Call me when you have something."
"What a novel idea."
He didn't bother replying to that, and instead hung up. Tossing the phone on the bed for now, Frost stood up and scanned the discarded pile of clothes on the floor, finally finding her vest top and underwear. She tried to ignore Rick's look of disappointment as she hurriedly dressed.
"My boss, duty calls,"
she said by way of apology.
"Get your clothes on."
The younger man looked at her in disbelief.
"Seriously?"
"Yeah, seriously."
Reaching down, she grabbed his jeans and tossed them to him.
60 seconds from now, you're leaving with or without your clothes."
Rick glared at her in annoyance, but nonetheless started to pull the jeans on.
"Your boss is a real asshole. You know that?"
Frost flashed a crooked smile.
"Yeah. Yeah, he is."
Chapter 6. Interstate 95, north of Washington, D.C., 19th of December, 2008. Anya was cruising north on the interstate highway in a rented Chevy Aveo, keeping her speed at a steady 70 miles per hour to avoid police attention. Just as well, really, because she doubted the underpowered saloon was capable of much more. Still, she had made good progress in the past hour. After making her escape from the rooftop, it had been a brisk walk 3 blocks north to her car. She could have run such a distance easily, but running attracted attention. That was one thing she didn't need today. Instead, she chose a steady, ground-covering pace that saw her in her car within 5 minutes. Nobody challenged her. Nobody suspected her. Nobody even paid attention to her, in fact. She was a Caucasian woman, dressed in respectable clothes and displaying completely unthreatening behavior. Why would they? She hadn't even broken stride as a Metro PD cruiser roared past, sirens wailing and blue lights flashing. She had known the cops inside hadn't seen her, just as the people she walked past on the street didn't really see her. Living in a large city like DC, they were used to not seeing people. Less than 7 minutes after the attack, and with emergency services only just starting to vector police units to the scene, she was in her car and on her way out of DC. Now, an hour later, she was approaching Wilmington, just one of thousands of other motorists rumbling down the big interstate highway. She exhaled, allowing herself to relax just a little. The first phase of the operation had been a success. She had done her part and escaped more or less without incident, leaving her free to move on to her next objective. But her relief was tempered by unease at the unexpected arrival of Drake in the very midst of the attack. Such interference had brought her to the edge of disaster. Had he interrupted at the crucial moment, she might have missed her shots entirely. Demachev would still be free, and her plan would have been in tatters. Her grip tightened on the wheel. Such an encounter simply couldn't have been random chance. Anya had long ago stopped believing in coincidences.
A sniper position had been nowhere near his home or place of work, or any logical commuting route between the two. He'd been there because he'd intended to be. But why? And why had he drawn a weapon on her? She was reluctant to consider him a threat after everything they had been through together. But Drake's interference was an unwelcome and dangerous variable in a plan that depended on many elements working together in perfect harmony, each event creating the conditions for the ones to follow. A man like him could unbalance everything, whether he intended to or not. She could not allow that to happen. She reached for the bottle of water in the cup holder to her right and took a drink. It wasn't exactly champagne, but then she didn't exactly feel like celebrating. A lot still had to happen for her to reach her goal, and as she had learned already tonight, a lot could still go wrong. She was just replacing the bottle when her cell phone buzzed with an incoming text message. Glancing down at it unobtrusively in case an unmarked police car happened to pull her over for the minor violation, she opened the message. "Have dropped Brett off. He was very grateful. See you for drinks on Sunday." Anya wasn't sure whether to feel good about that or not. Brett was their code word for Demachev, which in this case meant he had given up the information they needed. She doubted he would have given it up willingly, though she preferred not to think about what had been done to him to force him to talk. In either case, he was certainly dead by now. If what she'd heard about him was true, his death wasn't undeserved. Still, such things were out of her hands. She had other tasks to accomplish, chief amongst which was getting herself out of the United States as soon as possible. According to her dash-mounted GPS, it was over 450 miles to the Canadian border, and another 50 or so more to Montreal International Airport. She had a long night ahead of her if she wanted to make her morning flight, and was beginning to wish she'd brought a thermos of coffee for the ride. Settling back into the driver's seat, she flicked on the radio and waited while attuned to a local station. As she'd expected, it was dominated by coverage of the attack. Chapter 7. By now well clear of the crime scene, Drake was ensconced in a small coffee shop near Union Street on the northeast side of central DC. His mood was as dark as the steaming liquid in his cup, not helped by the constant coverage of the sniper attack playing on a TV mounted above the service counter. Anya's handiwork laid out for the world to see. But why? Police follow-up from his escapade on the rooftop was unlikely now. Neither officer had seen his face, and he'd make good his escape from the immediate area before backup could arrive. He'd been obliged to buy a new jacket and jeans from the nearest department store to eliminate the chance of a clothing match, but he could live with that. The only thing they could use against him was his English accent, and even that was unlikely to help much in a city that saw a regular influx of foreign tourists. For now, at least, he was in the clear. His unhappy contemplation was interrupted when his phone started ringing. It was Franklin. Snatching it up, he inputted his date calculator access code and hit the green button to take the call.
"What have you got, Dan?"
"News, and none of it good,"
his friend began.
"You were right about those mercs. They were part of a Russian diplomatic convoy fresh in from Andrew's AFB. It didn't take much effort to spot the link to Anya. She had been incarcerated in a Russian jail when Drake had found her. The exact reasons for her imprisonment were unknown, but clearly she was important to them, and it seemed she was now returning the favor.
"We're still getting police reports in, but we know both drivers were killed by high-velocity sniper rounds. The damn things punched right through the bulletproof windshields like they weren't even there."
"Yeah, I saw the gun," Drake confirmed. "Looked like it could take out a tank."
"It gets better. The survivors were executed at close range by small arms fire. Double taps to the head. Real professional."
Drake wasn't surprised. He would expect nothing less from any operation that Anya was a part of.
"So, the paramedics I saw were there to finish the job."
"This wasn't just an assassination," Franklin went on. "According to the convoy manifest, we've got an MIA, Anton Demachev, director of the FSB's counterterrorism branch."
Drake felt as though he was immersed in a bad dream, and it was getting worse by the minute. The convoy that had been hit belonged to Russia's Federal Security Bureau, better known as the FSB. When the Soviet Union dissolved in 1991, the old KGB broke up into a number of successor agencies, all vying for power and influence. The FSB had eventually emerged as the dominant entity and was now the main intelligence service of the Russian Federation, responsible for both foreign and domestic security. Essentially, they were the CIA and the FBI rolled into one. As such, their power and resources were considerable, and as many in Russia and elsewhere had learned to their cost, they weren't shy about flexing their political and military muscles.
"So this was an abduction," he said, stating the obvious.
"Looks that way. The Russians are going apeshit over this. If they hold him to ransom, it will be a PR disaster."
Franklin was silent for a moment, and Drake could almost feel his growing anger.
"Anya might have caused a goddamn international incident."
Drake looked down at his coffee. He could think of nothing to say to that, because his friend might well be right. Her actions this evening had already resulted in several deaths, not to mention incurring the wrath of one of the world's most dangerous intelligence services.
"What are we doing about it?" he asked instead.
With an incident of this magnitude, an agency response was inevitable.
"We're coordinating with FBI and Homeland Security, trying to figure out where they took him. But it's slow going."
Drake could guess why. Cooperation between America's security services was less than impressive at the best of times, and with a sudden attack like this, just piecing together what had happened could take hours. They were a sledgehammer, when what was needed was a scalpel. Fortunately, Drake had just the instrument in mind.
"I have to go, Dan," he said as his phone buzzed to let him know another caller was trying to reach him. "I'll call you back if I have anything new."
"Likewise."
Ending his call with Franklin, Drake immediately hit the accept button to take one from Frost. He could only hope she had good news.
"Yeah, Kira."
"I think we've got him," the young woman announced without preamble. "Our friends from the freeway dumped the ambulance at an underground parking lot on the east side of DC. Then they switched vehicles. They must have handled the transport."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.